Morning.
Morning.
And I bid you blessings and peace in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to be with you this morning. It was supposed to be Pastor Spray, and I was actually on my way back from a meeting in Orlando, and the phone rang, asked if I could be here this morning to fill in for him. Please keep him in your prayers. He's doing okay, but still having some health issues. And very happy to be here this morning. Looking forward to visiting with you a little bit after service this morning. Just looking at the announcements here, it looks like the prominent thing is a lot going on. The Wednesday soup and chili and salad dinners are progressing. I know we enjoy those a great meal with the Lent service following at 7 p.m. And it looks like next Sunday is the deadline for articles for the dove, and also for ordering Easter plants. We begin the service with our lector leading in a prayer for future past.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for all your blessings you have given to the Salem congregation these many years. We ask now with humble hearts for your direction and selection of the pastor for Salem. Help us to be patient with hope in our hearts, trusting totally in you, because you have promised to hear us. We ask this in faith, that you have already chosen a new shepherd. We thank you and trust in your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We join in our opening hymn. We're singing number 289. Please say. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. confess my transgressions to the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I ever offended you, and justly deserve your temple and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter, suffering, and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive me all my sins, and grant me the power of your Holy Spirit that I may amend my sinful life. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of God and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you see that of ourselves we have no strength. By your mighty power, defend us from all adversities that may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Genesis chapter 1, starting at the first verse. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation. And I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran, and Abram took Sarah his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all the possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord, and Abram journeyed on, still going toward the Negev. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The song is Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber.
Indeed, he who watches over you will not slumber or sleep.
The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand.
The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life.
The Lord will watch over your coming.
starting at the first and 13th verse. What then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but trusts him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness, just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. For the promise of Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs. Faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to the adherent of the law, but also to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence things that do not exist. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand to the verse for me.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be
be seated. Our hymn is 362.
To be
followed in calculations or other problem-solving operations, especially by a computer. So I guess when you go online, there are algorithms which can kind of detour you, control where to go. If I look something up, I guess some guy, some wizard of Oz, sits behind a curtain somewhere, he's programmed this thing, and so if I ask a question, it'll send me over here in this direction. So much for algorithms. Here's another one that I don't understand. Artificial intelligence. Have you been hearing about artificial intelligence? Now these things, these robots, can think for themselves, which frightens the heck out of me. You know, they actually develop kind of a personality. You know, the idea of computers not only can become smarter than we are, but they'll take on, I guess, dimensions of personality. They start to think for themselves. That's frightening because I've seen movies. Matrix, Terminator, Blade Runner. Those movies were prophetic. Because you can kind of see where this thing is going. I don't understand this stuff. I don't get it. 3D printers. Have you heard about 3D printers? Now you can actually print. See, I'm used to a photocopier where I go over there and I put a piece of paper down and duplicates it. These 3D printers, you can print a gun. You can print a chair. You can print a desk. You can print an entire house, I've been told. I don't understand this. I don't understand how it's even possible. And I gave up doing my own taxes long ago. And because there are so many rules, you used to just figure out a percentage and send it in. Not anymore. You know, I look under the hood of my car, and I don't understand what I'm looking at. And I know how to fill the windshield wiper fluid reservoir. Aside from that, something goes wrong, I don't know what to do. Just about everything in my vehicle now is controlled by some kind of computer chip. I don't know anything about these computer chips. I don't know where they're located. I don't know how they fix them or replace them. I don't understand this stuff. All I know is I gotta pay some guy big bucks because I don't have the expertise anymore. I don't understand how my car works. I don't understand when it doesn't work. My grandfather used to fix things with a wing nut and a piece of wire. And now it's also complicated. It's also complicated. I have a cell phone that I hold in my hand, and I bet I don't use half of its capabilities. And the entire world can come to me through that cell phone. And I can communicate with the rest of the world with that cell phone. I don't understand it. I don't get it. Investments. Now there are thousands of different kinds of investments. Once more investing is in finance, much more complicated than it used to be. Every other day some kind of report comes out, and then the market goes up, the market goes down. I don't understand these forces at work. You know what I learned in school? The law of supply and demand. Wow, that wasn't complicated, was it? You know, if there's fewer certain things that people want, the price goes up. If there's a lot of those things that people want, the price goes down. It's pretty simple. It wasn't complicated. People bought and sold things. Now the international scene, that's complicated. Some terrorist sitting over there in Chechnya, wherever he happens to be. Now he has the ability to send the virus to my computer. And theoretically, I guess they have the ability to take down the electric grid sitting over keep people alive that would have been possible perhaps for that person to continue living given their physical condition. So now we have a big ethical dilemma. How far do we go with this thing? You know, when do we hook up a person to a machine? And when is it morally irresponsible to do so? You can't even die in the back bedroom anymore. It's all complicated. They can operate on babies in the womb. So there's a whole bunch of moral and ethical issues that go along with that. The question becomes, you know, just because we can do something, should we do something? Has that gotten obligated? My mom used to say, finish your homework and then go out and play. Wow, that wasn't complicated, was it? Now every kid has, you know, the question is, when do we give a kid a cell phone? What kind of restrictions do we place on the cell phone? Because the whole world can come to that child right from the cell phone, including a lot of not so good stuff. So, this world of ours has become so complicated. The last thing you need is a complicated sermon. Right? Last thing you need is to walk out here going, what was that about? So I'm going to pray for your sermon this morning. John 3:16. Say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Simple text. Simple text. Simple message for you this morning. Yeah, the amazing thing is that simple text, John 3:16, actually contains some profound sentiments, doesn't it? It goes to the very heart of our Christian faith and what we believe as Christians. It contains within itself the essentials of the Christian faith. And that's why Martin Luther called it the little Bible. And what he was saying was that the message of the Bible, you boil it all down, it's in that one simple verse. Sometimes it's referred to as the gospel in a nutshell. You ever heard that? So let's do it again. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now I'm just going to break it down into four parts. Four parts. Four parts. Part one. For God so loved the world. That word world is not a reference to dirt, flowers, trees, shrubs. It's a reference to people in this case. Doesn't mean God doesn't love his creation, that's fine. He does. But in this instance, for God's love of the world, it's a reference to human beings, to people. And so the first point I'd make this morning is, God loves us. He loves you. He loves me. He loves all of us. You may not even love yourself. And as you sit here this morning, but God loves you. Now why is that important? Because it has been proven exhaustively. It is absolutely true. Without the assurance that we are loved, we human beings suffer extremely negative consequences. People who feel unloved are subject to chronic illness, either physical or mental, and eventually, infants, if they are not loved and cared for, they suffer from a syndrome known as failure to thrive. Have you heard about that? If they're not loved and nurtured and cared for, they don't gain weight the way they should. They're sick. So this is true from our earliest days on earth. We want to be loved. Call it other things. Call it acceptance. Call it approval. Just keep it simple and direct. What we want most, what we need most, is to be loved. But the fact of the matter is, a lot of times we don't feel loved. And sometimes we feel we're unlovable. And any counselor will tell you this is a big issue. Woman sits in a pastor's office. You feel loved. She's like, by whom? My parents, they didn't love me. They didn't want me. And it's translated then into a bunch of failed relationships. She's, woman sits there and she says, I've never had any real friends to speak of. She says, look at me. Do you see anything worth loving? So the human heart cries out for the assurance that somebody loves us, somebody cares. Because without that knowledge, we die. And we may not die physically at first, but we'll die on the inside. Robert Browning, the well-known poet, wrote, quote, take away love, and earth is a tomb. It's true. For God so loved the world, pretty simple. God loves you, the Greek word here, the one you probably know is agape. Agape is a sacrificial love, a love that doesn't ask anything in return. Spends itself for the sake of the other. That's the kind of love that God has for you. He doesn't love you because, hey, I'm going to get some kind of reward. He just loves you. And he loves you no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done. He loves you no matter what. No matter how great your sins are in your own eyes or in the eyes of other people, he still loves you. God so loved the world. That's the first part. Here's number two. Here's the second part. That he gave his one only son. God gave his one only son. In my Pennsylvania parish, we were still allowed to have live Christmas trees in church. We'd go cut a couple big ones at Christmas time, and we'd set those trees up. And then the tradition was that every year, when we took down the trees, we take one of them outside, we take one of those big trees outside, saw off all the branches, and we would take the trunk, cut down, form a cross. You could do that back in the days when you could have live trees in church. But it was a great message, wasn't it? Because what it was saying is God sent his son at Christmas to die on the cross. Clearly communicated. So, why would God want to do that? Why would God want to be willing to give up his son? Verses 17 and 18. And he speaks to this. God sent his son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God didn't send his son into the world to condemn you. He sent his son into the world to save you. St. Paul's Cathedral in London is this giant statue, big statue. Jesus is hanging on the cross, he's writhing in agony. It's a very simple inscription on the bottom. This is how much God loved the world. Says it all. didn't just love the world, he gave his son. He gave him to death on the cross for you and for me. St. Thomas Aquinas, great medieval theologian, wrote volumes and volumes and volumes of theology. He spent time worshiping at the foot of the cross, and he came back and he said, he wrote, to that which I have seen today makes it all I have written, all I have ever written, trash. Karl Barth, a great modern theologian, shortly before his death, they said to him, Dr. Barth, what's the greatest theological truth you have discovered? And his answer was, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. For God so loved the world. God loves you. God loves me. How do I know that? He gave his only son into death on the cross. For you and for me. Part three. That whoever believes in him, that whoever believes in him. This is the third point. It's kind of an invitation, isn't it? Believe on him. Believe on him. I like this point because it's so simple and so direct. It goes to the very heart of the Christian faith. We, in our circles, like to say that faith is basically trust. Faith is trust. Trusting Christ that he did for us what we could never do for ourselves, that he lived the perfect life for us that we could never live on account of our sin. And our good friend Abraham, he offered up that sinless life on Calvary's cross as a sacrifice for the sins of humanity. So that we need not suffer the consequences of our sin. You know what the problem is? People out there, they complicate Christianity. They think Christianity is an extremely complicated thing. And the fact of the matter is, it is not a complicated thing. The message is an exceedingly simple one. They think that Christianity, non-church populations, people outside the Christian church, oftentimes they think that Christianity is a set of rules to follow. And it's not. That's not what Christianity is. Christianity has to do with a relationship with Jesus Christ the Savior. And living in him and for him. Pretty simple. Trust him. Trust that he offered himself on the cross for you, that he died for you, and the scripture says you have the gift of life. The gift of life, new life in this world, eternal life in the future. And then, finally, part four, should not perish. Should not perish, but have eternal life. When I ask people, John 3:16, is it law or is it gospel? Most of the time people come back and say, well, it's gospel. And probably for the most part it is. But there is law there. And the law is contained in that single word, perish. Isn't it? Those who believe in Jesus Christ, those who believe the story of a medium priest. One night announced to the congregation that he was about to preach the greatest sermon ever preached. And he told them to gather in the church in the evening, like one of our Lenten services. And they sat there with descending darkness. And finally he came out of sacristy with a candle in this totally dark church. And he took that candle and he held it, went out to the, behind the altar was this large crucifix. And he held the light up. He held the candle out, first to one hand. Then he crossed over so that the light was shed on the other pierced hand, pierced by a nail. And he held up the crown of thorns on the Savior's head. And he held it in front of the cruelly spiked feet. And finally, he held up to the pierced side. And he walked out. Pretty effective, wasn't it? A sermon without words. The Sermon on the Holy Ghost. John 3:16. For God so loved the world. God loves you. God loves me. God loves all of us. That he gave his only begotten Son. He sent his Son to die for you. And whoever believes in him, trusts in him, that he died on the cross for us. Whoever trusts in the crucified one shall not perish, but have eternal life. We join together in confessing our faith in the words of the apostles. Please. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. And then he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Senior, for evil, be hindered, and for freedom, that the gospel be preached in every place and to every people, that they become with us sons and daughters of Abraham by faith. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for grace, let me give thanks to God for all his gifts and blessings, for his mercies due every morning, and for generous hearts, that we return to him the tithes and offerings with our song of praise. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Lord, have mercy, and grant us your grace always. Amen.
Please be seated. Angels, and with all the company of heaven, we long to magnify your glorious name.
that we will praise you and sing.
Thank you.
May this, the long and love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in steadfast and true faith, on divine promise, in heart and peace. Amen. Please stand with prayer. Let your blessing be upon us, Heavenly Father, as we pass through these holy days, in which we remember the sufferings and death of our dear Lord, and grant that this holy example being ever before us, we may follow him in willing obedience, gracious humility, and the sacrificial spirit. Through him who loved us and gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you favor and give unto you his peace. Closing in is 96.